raining again. I wonder if it's raining in Moscow. Oh, the poor darling sisters.
Sisters, sisters, there were never such devoted sisters. We're off to Moscow, Moscow. Oh, how we wanna go to Moscow. We really must go to dear old Moscow now.
Chekhov's Three Sisters, starring the Beverly Sisters, Joy, Babs and Teddy, as the tragic trio. Part of a series bringing classic plays to a wider audience, including Percy Edwards as the Seagull, Dostoevsky's The Idiot, starring Giles Brandreth, and Henrik Ibsen's The Wild Duck, starring Orville, with Keith Harris.
To Who Dares Wins, and tonight we're looking at the technology of the future, such as the new stock exchange supercomputer, which can do everything that the modern broker can do. It can collate world prices, it can analyze stock fluctuations, it can tip off its friends, split the proceeds, and then piss off to the Bahamas.
And we'll be looking at what scientists claim is a new wonder cure for total deafness. It's called living next door to Ian Paisley.
And we'll also be looking at the technical difficulties which are now besetting the new American space shuttle, like how to maintain fuel efficiency, how to monitor the fail-safe system, and most difficult of all, how to persuade someone to get inside it. But first, microtechnology, and with me is Peter Smith, the man who's just invented the smallest TV yet. Welcome, Peter.
Hello.
Well, would you like to show it to us?
Yes, here it is, Jimmy.
All right. Well, it's quite small, isn't it?
Yes, very small, very compact, very convenient.
Mm-hmm. Any disadvantages at all?
Jimmy, for instance, on a television this size, anyone as small as, say, Bonnie Langford is totally invisible to the human eye.
So no disadvantages then?
No.
Well, could we see this brilliant piece of microtechnology in action?
Certainly, I'll just pull in the aerial.
Terry?
Yes, mate?
I didn't make a fool of myself, did I?
Of course you didn't. You made history, mate. You are the first male panda ever to have given birth.
Am I?
Yes. You were on the news at 10.
Oh, bloody hell, not the cuddly item at the end again.
No. Big news, straight after the Queen Mother's ingrowing toenail.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh. Terry?
Yes?
Where is it?
Where's what?
My baby.
Oh, that. It's around here somewhere.
I want to hold it.
Do you? It's a vicious little bugger.
Terry, it's probably craving its mother's breast. It's amazing. This birth is a life-changing experience, you know. I'm not just your old mate Wang Wang anymore. I'm my mother.
It's not going to affect our poker evening, is it?
Terry!
All right.
I want to hold my baby.
All right.
It's important for bonding.
Yes, all right. Oi, you, get in here. Come and say hello to your mother. All right. right, Shirley bloody Temple, calm down. You know he's been charging them by the photograph out there. What do you got your end? I've told you before, no pulling the tails off the baby raccoons. What am I going to say to the parents?
There, Uncle Terry didn't mean it.
He's an evil little sod, you know. He's been feeding the penguins.
There's no law against that.
To the polar bears. Oi, you, get out of there. That's my new tyre.
He's teething.
And don't go playing the mummy's boy either. You little bastard, come here. I'll give you what for, come here. Right. Wang Wang, that is it. He's got to go. Wangy, he's got... Look, Wangy. Wangy! My old mate, my old mucker. We were all right before...
Baby
arrived. And we'll be all right after they take him away. Look, remember the old days, eh? Crapping in the food trough. Wanking off in front of the tourists. It was marvellous. What a team!
Boy, take baby away. Never.
Look, Wangy, don't cry. You'll burst your stitches.
I haven't got any stitches.
You must have stitches. It was a caesarean.
They put a zip in case they wanted any more.
A zip?
Yeah.
What do they think you are, a bloody pyjama case?
Terry, don't shout. You'll upset baby. All look, right. Be nice to him for my sake.
Oh, all right. Oi, kid. Look, I'm sorry I was a bit rude to you, like, but it's a bit strange, all this business, right? So I say we want to stay clean. Let's be mates. Put it there. Oh! Oh! Little fuck, you come here! I'll give you something.
Look, bad news for sports fans, I'm afraid. We've just heard that the England cricket team is beset by injuries for the second test against Australia. Apparently, several of the players fainted when they discovered that they'd won the first one.
Last year, more working days were lost through back pain than any other reason except royal weddings. With me, I have Julian Porter. Julian is a back specialist. Julian, what can be done?
Well, Tony, the problem is largely one of posture. For example, how would you sit at this desk?
Well, I suppose something like this.
Ah, yes. Quite natural, but unfortunately you're placing far too much strain on the small of your back here.
Really?
And on your neck here, you can probably feel that. Yes. Basically, you're storing up a lot of problems for your future.
Okay, Julian, what can be done?
Well, I'll show you. Here we are. Nice and comfy.
This is the optimum back position, is it?
Oh, yes. You can see my spine is totally supported along its entire length. At no point is it subject to undue stretching.
And how do you work in this position?
Well, you've hit upon a major hiccup there, Tony. The trouble is, desk manufacturers have hitherto irresponsibly designed desks upside down. You see, ideally, they should be hanging from the ceiling.
Another major cause of back problems, of course, is the car.
Yes, well, here again, Tony, the problem is one of posture. Driving posture this time.
Well, Julian, perhaps you'd like to show us the correct posture.
There you are. As you can see now, my spine is again totally supported.
A lot of people might say it's not too easy to drive in that position.
And they'd be right. Here again, I blame the manufacturers. You see, the plain and simple truth is, Tony, it's very difficult to reach the steering wheel from the roof of an average family car.
I see. Are there any other situations which are harmful to the back?
Indeed, the toilet.
Yes,
you
well...
You see, I don't think people should use the toilet at all. I think the floor is an...
Later
I mean,
on...
look at this. Just the act of removing your trousers.
Thank you.
Very, very
position. Julian. Later on, we'll be looking at President Reagan's admission that it was a mistake to send arms to Iran. He meant to send them to Iraq.
You see, what you should do is, when you get down here, is just to...
Later on, we'll be asking questions about the plans to farm the ocean bed. Questions such as... won't all the cows drown? But first of all, we're talking about pets, and tonight we're looking at the domestic...
We bought a little dog the other week. It was an Afghan hound, very sweet little thing.
Oh, yeah. How does it smell then? Pretty whiffy, I suppose.
No, it doesn't smell at all, actually, Julia. It's very cute.
Oh, come on. I bet it chucks up a bit, though, doesn't it? They all do.
They don't all do, Julia. In fact, there's no reason that a dog, if properly trained, should smell at all.
What do you do, train them not to sweat or something?
No, and if hacked for your information, dogs don't sweat. They pant, no sweat glands, you see.
Yeah, but there must be something oozing out of them to make all that smell. I mean, oh, I suppose it's some kind of skin disease, is it? Athlete's dog, halitosis, something like that, is it? Oh, it could, of course, be the urine, couldn't it? Because that always shoots everywhere, doesn't it?
It's quite obvious that you know nothing at all about dogs. There's no reason at all why a dog, if properly looked after, should smell at all. Pizza. All you do is to cook.
Pizza, mate. Pizza. Pizza, American hot extra chilies.
Something's gone wrong here. Can you just go and see that chap over there? Because we're right in the middle of doing something over here. Sorry about that. sorry, go back. There's no reason why they should smell at all as long as they are washed regularly and then combed afterwards.
What, to get all the fleas and lice and crabs and things?
No, come on, I've got other deliveries to make. I've ordered a pizza.
But I didn't order, did you?
No.
I think you got the wrong place, mate. If you go out there, go out through to reception, I'm sure they'll sort you out, all right?
Yeah. to get all the fleas and lice and crabs?
Yeah, look, somebody ordered a pizza. What's your name, mate?
That's none of your business.
Is it Mr. Meagle, is it?
No, it's Mulville, actually.
Oh, thank you, Jimmy.
Well, I just want to help. Just help clear up the confusion.
Well, come on, mate, you're only £7.80. Yeah.
Just go away, will you?
Come until you pay for your pizza.
Pay him, Jimmy.
Pay for a bloody pizza I don't want.
That's bloody typical, and it's always happening, this. People come over pissed, they order a bloody pizza, and then they change their minds. But I'm not going until you're paid. Come on.
Look, friend, I'm not pissed. I didn't order this pizza. I'm not paying for it.
Please, we're actually in the middle of something. And if you could just hang on a moment.
John,
we'll sort it out in a minute, honestly.
I've got to have a delivery, yeah,
it's not going to take long, I promise. Okay?
Please. All right.
Thank you.
to get all the fleas and lice and crabs and things out.
I'm not paying for that bloody pizza, all right?
No!
I'm not paying for a bloody pizza I didn't even order.
That's what you think, Sasha.
Well, you're giving a 50 pound!
Jimmy, please, look, let's just do the dog, please. We'll sort it out in a minute, okay? Just hang on.
Christ! Who let this guy in?
Fleas and lice and crabs and things out. Jimmy.
Yes, dogs don't have to have fleas and lice and things, Julia. At all.
Well, they collect them because they like them.
No, with proper hygiene, you...
Hang in! you Jimmy Rigville?
No, it's Jimmy Mulville.
Julia?
Just take the package, Jimmy.
All right, give us the package.
Oh, it's payment on delivery.
Oh, is it? Well, stuff it!
Well, I'm not going for any money.
Please, we're in the middle of it. Can't you just wait till we've finished?
Well, as long as I get paid.
You will, yes,
Jimmy. He won't!
Jimmy, look, do the dog, please.
No, it's Miggle.
Just do the lines about the dog.
It's Miggle.
He says it's not Rigville.
No, it's Miggle. Dogs that... Dogs don't have to have fleas and lice and things.
Mini cab for Mr. Goldville.
Oh, Jesus.
Goldville? Anyone?
Jimmy, we all know that dogs are a health hazard.
Well,
you just
a
have
cab.
To go.
No, it's Goldville.
See,
it's
Miggle.
No, it's Rigville.
Goldville. It's Miggle.
I think you'll find it's Mulville on your.
Oh, Mulville. Mulville.
Mulville. Look, you lot! You don't pipe down, no one's getting any money, all right?
If I don't get paid, I'm going to shove this pizza right up your arse. Without folding it.
Having an unfolded pizza shoved up your arse is just one of the many problems people have been writing to me about. For example, a Mr. Lloyd of Vauxhall writes, "Dear Rory, I'm worried about the size of my genitals." Well, don't worry, Mr. Lloyd. Size isn't important. What matters is how big it is. And also a Carrie Johnson of Northampton has written to me asking, "Dear Rory, at what time of the month am I most likely to get pregnant?" Well, Carrie, the answer is about 11:30 Saturday night now, I think.
It's funny, isn't it?
What?
Well, I feel sort of down. Sad. Mm. You know? I often do afterwards.
Mm. Me too.
It's quite natural, I mean. Everyone feels a bit sad after they just made love. I wonder why. Is it because you regret it all over? Or because it sort of proves the pointlessness of existence, you know, something like that?
No. I feel sad because you're no good at it.
Oh.
Come in.
Just sit in the chair, will you? I won't keep you a moment.
Well, you're from Australia, then?
Yep. Is that a problem for you?
No, heavens, no. I've heard it's a fascinating country. You know, I've always really wanted to go there, actually.
Meaning what exactly?
Meaning I've always wanted to go there, to see it.
To see what?
Well...
To see a bunch of illiterate descendants of convicts swilling lager, calling each other Bruce, pissing over their wives, shearing sheep on surfboards, I suppose. Open up.
Oh, no.
That hurt?
Well, yes, it did, actually.
It's gonna have to come out, I'm afraid.
Oh, is it?
Trying to tell me my job?
No. Wouldn't dream of it. Of course, lots of really good things have come out of Australia over the past few years, haven't they? I mean, there's been some wonderful Australian entertainers and...
Rolf Harris?
No. I didn't mean... I was thinking more of, Clive James?
Name another one. Open up.
The film industry!
What?
The Australian film industry is wonderful. It's wonderful, tremendous talent.
Who?
Bruce Beresford, Peter Weir, Judy Davis, Mel Gibson, the Australian wine's wonderful. Germaine Greener, she's a remarkable woman. Kiri Takano, a lovely voice, lovely.
She's from New Zealand.
Yes, but I'm sure you could hear her in Australia, couldn't you?
Okay, I get the message. Relax, relax.
You're not offended?
No, it's just that some English people have a certain image of us Australians, and I thought you were one of them.
Oh, well, I'm not, no.
No, I can see that now, but...
Good.
Still gonna have to come out, I'm afraid.
Well, if you say it's gotta come out, then it's gotta come out.
Okay, well, tell me what you wanna do. Do you want a local anaesthetic or a general one?
The blind woman who regained her sight after 20 years saw her first episode of Howard's Way on Sunday and has asked if she can go blind again.
This is Dave. Hi, Dave.
Hi.
Now, Dave, you're a professional criminal.
Right, that's what I do for a living, yeah.
So basically, you beat people up so you can get their money off them.
No, I'll beat people up so I can get money off the News of the World reporter who follows me around taking photographs.
I see. Now, John, you are the News of the World reporter who follows Dave around, so obviously you work quite closely together as a team.
Well, that's right, Julia. Dave is, in fact, one of our top full-time crime exclusives. Dave's actually committed over 80% of all the crimes we feature on our newspaper.
But with this kind of work, isn't there a risk of Dave going to prison?
Oh, there certainly is, that's right. And he's done some of his best stuff for us inside prison. He's done us I Meet the Stepney Strangler, Reggie Cray Ate My Hamster, I Am the Stepney Strangler, I Ate the Stepney Strangler, and, of course, I Ate the Hamster that Ate Reggie Cray.
Right, I see. Now, Dave, the beating up end of the job, I mean... What are the hours like?
Oh, it's evenings mostly. 6 to 9 is mugging old ladies. 9 to 12,
police work.
Stabbing policemen. And then after midnight, it's just sort of general looting, yeah. If John's running one of his inner city volcano exclusives. Sometimes I have to black out for that one.
Yeah, if we're playing up the racial angle, and we usually are.
Yes.
Yeah.
And do you ever have to work weekends?
Or? Well, Saturdays I'll go down to Chelsea because we're doing our We Are Master Football Fags.
Yeah, it's a series.
Yeah. I'm getting £6,000 for that.
Really, £6,000?
Yeah, £1,000 for doing the assaults and £5,000 for having to watch Chelsea.
That's a very fascinating career, and now it's competition time.
Well, this week, we want you to arrange these words into a well-known phrase or saying. Join us next week when our celebrity guest, Leon Britton, will be playing Stop the Clock, just by looking at it.
Reports are coming in that Princess Diana might just possibly be pregnant. So far, there's been no official confirmation, but eyewitnesses report seeing the princess sitting down at a public function. We go over live to Dennis Hughes at Buckingham Palace.
While I'm here in the Buckingham Palace toilet, the very toilet which Princess Di is thought to have used this morning. And I can now reveal that there are, in fact, traces of vomit around the inside of the bowl. At least I think it's vomit. It could be lumps of congealed vim, but I reckon it's vomit. Whether, of course, it's Princess Di's or not, well, we shall have to wait and see. With that, back to the studio.
Well, to cover this important story more fully, we have, of course, cancelled all advertised programmes for the next 10 months.
All very exciting. Now, with me in the studio, I have Audrey Chubb. Audrey, you're a royal watcher. What does this entail?
Well, Tony, basically, I follow the royals around and I watch them.
Sounds terrific. A really great career.
Yes, it is.
Tell us, is Di pregnant?
Well, I think she might possibly be pregnant, yes. But there again, she may not be. You see, there are two ways of looking at it. But either way, it's very exciting. I mean, it gives the whole country the most enormous lift. I mean, she is the most amazing woman. She has babies, she goes dancing, she wears pop socks. I don't know how she finds the time. She's an inspiration to us all.
This will be her third child, won't it? She must be very fertile.
Fecund. She is fecund. And, of course, Charles is incredibly potent, a stud. Together, they are the most fantastic biological success story. Of course, they are helped by the male Windsor ears, which are especially good for mating, as they give you something to hang on to.
And all this is included in your latest book?
Yes, my new book, Princess Di, a fantastic woman, yes.
But this isn't the first book that you've written on the subject.
Oh, no, Tony, no. It's my 946th book about her. Of course, she is more than a mere woman. She is, in a very real sense, a goddess. And in the spring, I'm bringing out my new book, Princess Diana, the Celestial Goddess. And in that, I'll be discussing the fact that she is immortal, that she did, in fact, spring from the loins of Zeus when he visited her mother, the Countess Spencer, in the guise of a swan, and also her early years on Mount Olympus, her dislike for Polo and Poseidon.
Ah, gentlemen, just in time. What do you think, eh? Impaling at its best.
Oh, dear.
It's not finished yet. Look, here's one I did earlier.
It's the impaling we've come to talk to you about, my lord.
What's the problem?
It's got to stop.
Yes.
Have you run out of wood?
No, it's not proving too popular with the masses, sir.
The thing is, we think it's time you changed your image.
Yes.
But I am Vlad the Impaler, King of Transylvania. I am Vlad V, am I not?
You mean Vlad the Fifth?
Oh, is that what the V stands for?
Yes. I never knew that.
Listen, you impale living people, right?
Right. And you do it well, very, very well indeed. I mean, if I were going to be impaled, I'd ask for you.
Careful.
But the fact is, the man in the street is fed up. He's bored.
Right through the top of his head.
It has to stop.
Oh, I don't know. Impaling's been very good to me. You're saying I should stop the impaling completely?
Exactly.
And just concentrate on eating babies?
Well, not so much eating them as try kissing them.
Why not try just mingling with your subjects?
Yes.
Mingling. I like the sound of that. I don't think I've ever mingled before.
You'll love it.
It is like mangling, I take it.
He's a mad...
What?
Nikolai is a little depressed. Apparently you impaled his brother last week.
Did I? Why did I do that?
Well, because he was there.
Where?
On top of a wooden spike.
Now, listen, you two. I'm not about to change my age just because a couple of...
Look, I think, sir, there are more important things you could be concentrating on.
More important than impaling? Name them.
Tax.
Unemployment?
Don't talk to me about unemployment.
Well, how about creating a more constructive foreign policy?
Oh, come on, last night I lay on a lavish banquet in honour of the Turkish ambassador.
During which you nailed his clothes to his body.
It was a joke! He's got no sense of humour, that bloke. Oh, we'd had a few, mind you, yeah.
Oh, and then you nailed his hat to the top of his head with 6-inch iron nails.
Let's talk about something else, shall we?
Well, what about tax?
There weren't any, that's why I used the nails. Now, can we talk about something else?
Look, perhaps we could improve your image if we changed your name.
Oh, good idea.
What's wrong with Vlad the Impaler?
Vlad, we love. It's the Impaler we're not too keen on.
No, I'm not changing that.
Oh, sorry. Just a little.
Such as?
Vlad the Impala?
Impala? What's that?
It's a nice little furry antelope. It's a little...
I'm not being named after a furry antelope.
I know.
Thank you very much.
What about Vlad the Former Impaler?
Yes, I like that. How about Uncle Vlad the Former Impaler?
Oh, yes. Too long.
Yes, you're right. Yes. How about just Uncle Vlad?
How about just Impaler?
I liked Uncle.
And I liked Former.
All right, then. How about Former Vlad the Uncle Impaler? Good, that's settled. Thank you, gentlemen.
I'm a dream lover, 'cause I love dreams. I'm the schemer in your head. I'll make you shake and sweat and scream. You're mine when you're in bed. And when you wake up, I make sure you're more tired than you were before. I know you'll see your shrink and say what you saw when you were asleep. He'll try and get you put away, then turn into a sheep. You pay him with a large ice cream, and then you know it's just a dream. It seems odd when you talk to God while standing in a stream. When you're asked what's happening by Charlie Chaplin, you must be in a dream. I'll send you on dates with stars you adore, like Marilyn Monroe. But I watch the clock, so I ensure before you come, she'll go. Your nightly dreams are full of thrills, unless you pay the cleaning bills. And when one day you leave for work and wonder why the people smirk, you'll end up feeling quite a jerk. No, it's just a dream. So sleep on soundly if you dare. You'll try in vain to run, and then you'll meet your brother there, who'll turn into a nun. And then she speaks with a paisley scream,
"You pepper scum, it's just a dream!"
It seems amazing when Granny plays in England's cricket team. You'll be surprised when you realize that's true and not a dream. I'll let the Inquisition get you, then you'll want to scream. But when you wake up in cold sweats, you'll find it's just a dream. Until when lying there relieved, you'll find one last trick up my sleeve.
Hello and welcome to Review.
What have you been doing, Roy?
Well, I've been reading Princess Michael's new book, which came out earlier this week.
And is it an easy read?
No, it's not, Tony. Some of the photocopying is really quite blurred. Anyway, next week I'll be reviewing the new TV series Great Journeys of the World, in which Michael Wood goes up the Amazon, David Attenborough treks up the Nile, and Nigel Dempster crawls up the rectum of anybody famous.
Over the next few weeks, we'll be giving useful hints to fifth formers, and this week a subject dear to most teenagers' heart, contraception. There are many forms of contraception on the market. There's the cap, the pill, or your parents coming home early from the pub. But the most common form is the sheath, the condom, or as the recent government pamphlet calls it, the thingy. There are two ways of purchasing these essential items. For example...
Can I help you, sir?
Yes, I'd like a packet of...
Yes?
Fisherman's Friends, please.
Wrong. Now look at this approach.
Come on, come on! Chop! Come on, I've got all day. There's girlies to hump out there.
Can I help you, sir?
Ah, yes. A dozen of your finest condoms, please. Five blue, two stripy, four standard, and one with the little rubbery horns on for extra stimulation.
Certainly, sir.
I want to try them on.
I don't think that's possible, sir.
Oh, I think it is. I'm not going to lash out on a dozen feather-like without trying them on for size, am I? Come on, give us a hand. Come on. I don't want them flying off and whacking me in the face.
There we are. The correct way to buy the condom. Without any blushes or embarrassment. Next week, we'll be showing you how to get on your teacher's tits by perfecting that look of dumb insolence.
Friends, it is always painful to bid farewell to a loved one. But I feel sure, knowing the deceased as I did, that a man who so much enjoyed life, laughter, and above all, happiness, would want us to remember him now, not with grief, but with warmth and affection. Because that is the sort of man that Arthur was. Arthur John Harold Sanderson believed in living life to the full.
Excuse me.
He knew that every second counted and...
Excuse me.
Sorry?
You got the wrong one.
What?
You're doing the wrong tribute. It's not him, it's not Arthur.
Isn't it?
No.
Oh, no, sorry, he's half past, yeah. Isn't he? sorry. A wise man once said that you can judge a man by his friends. And I can see by looking around me that Brian Peter Simpson was such a man. Those of us who knew him well knew him. It's not him either, is it? Sorry. Few men have left such a mark on those around them as has Charles Wilton Catchpole.
No.
In that case, tireless, robust, individualistic, but always well-meaning, Gerald Kipling.
No.
Well, it wasn't the uncomplaining cheery Martin Smith.
No.
At times difficult, but deep down genuinely kind, Pauline Treadwell?
No! Get on with it! It's Terry!
Terry?
Terry Brown.
Terry Brown, the...
corpse.
Terry Brown. Old Terry Brown. Good old Terry Brown. For those of us who knew Terry well, he was kind man? A very kind man, a warm, loving man, a warm, tender, loving...
Wife murderer.
Man with problems. Serious problems of a tragic kind. A warm, loving man whose passions got the better of him in a single moment of blind, uncontrollable, terrifying rage directed tragically at his poor, unfortunate wife.
Wives.
Two wives. And the other two. Terry was a man with problems. None of us here would deny that, but who are we to judge him? except, of course, the judge over there. What we must hope is that as Terry came to the end of his turbulent life, as he...
Staggered out the pub.
Staggered out of the pub, we must pray that, like Paul on the... He was mindful, was he not? Mindful of his past, heedful of his sins.
Pissed as a fart.
As a part, a fart. And, like Paul on the Damascus Road, we can only pray that at the end he had a moment's grace
Before he was...
cut down by a hail of police bullets.
Cut down by... oh, bugger it, he had it coming to him, didn't he?
There now follows a party political broadcast.
Hello there. Nice old Uncle Vlad here. You know, I spend a lot of time touring around this great country of ours, getting to know my subjects. And they say to me, Vlad, they say, we're worried about the price of bread. Vlad, they say, we're worried about our education. Vlad, they say, don't stick that wooden pole up my ass. And you know, I think they're right. And so in the future, I'm going to spend more time getting to know my subjects and what worries them. Just tell me what your problem is and what bothers you. And I'm sure I'll see the point. It'll be sticking out your head.
No, 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 no. Not for the head. Quite, sorry, not for the head.